Welcome everyone to Facebook Live here at the Hospital for Special Surgery here in New York City. Today we're going to be talking about minimally invasive surgery in total hip replacement. My name is Dr. Michael Alexiadis. I'm an orthopedic surgeon here at the Hospital for Special Surgery and have been on staff here for almost 30 years. I'm on the adult joint reconstruction service along with Dr. Peter Skolko, and also on staff at Weill Cornell as an associate professor. Peter,
yeah, sure.
You want to introduce yourself?
Sure thing, thank you. So my name is Peter Skolko. I'm assistant attending on the orthopedic surgery service, also on the hip and knee service. I did my training at HSS for my residency and went to Mayo Clinic for my adult reconstruction fellowship and been on staff here for 3 years, also specializing in hip replacement and revision surgery. So thanks for having me today.
All right, so what we're going to talk about is a topic called minimally invasive surgery. Most of you may have heard what that is, but what it really means, I think, is a very different thing for patients versus surgeons. Many surgeons would call it a misnomer. So, Peter, I'm gonna ask you what you think minimally invasive surgery means in the context of joint replacement.
Sure. I think all of us, patients and surgeons, want our patients to get back to their lifestyle as fast as possible. So, I think, for me, minimally invasive surgery means more of a rapid recovery. So, patients can get through their total hip replacement and get back to what they like to do, whether that's their physical exercise, back to work, enjoying time with their family without having any complication. How you achieve that, I think we're going to talk about in more detail today, involves good anesthesia and perioperative pain management, involves good surgical technique, and obviously good rehabilitation after surgery. I think we can break down our topics today focusing on those three categories.
So we're really not talking about incision size here.
Yeah.
We're really talking about what makes it easier for the patient in terms of less pain,
right,
and a quicker recovery. Often that can include a smaller incision,
mm-hmm,
but in the end, we still need to be able to do the procedure correctly, put the implants in correctly, mm-hmm, so that they work correctly,
exactly,
for as long as possible. So
right,
we don't want to sacrifice longevity,
right,
for a smaller incision.
I think that's a key point. I think there's a difference between mini incision surgery and minimally invasive surgery. I think that an incision that's 1 or 2 centimeters longer, which may provide excellent visualization, is really far beneficial to struggling with a smaller incision just for the sake of having a small incision. What's truly minimally invasive for what I think what we do is preservation of the deep musculature. That's number one, so we don't hurt the abductor muscle, which is the key muscle for gait and walking without a limb. And also putting in the parts which we're going to show you today to perfectly restore the patient's anatomy. And when you restore anatomy, then I think that the muscles behave the way they should, and that leads to a naturally fast recovery.
So I think patients need to understand that even in minimally invasive or MIS surgery, the implants are still going into the bone in the same place they are as they are in the maximally invasive surgery.
Right.
But it's what you do to that surrounding soft tissue that really makes a big difference. And for those of you who don't know what the gluteus medius is, that's the muscle that's here on the side of your hip that keeps your pelvis level so that when you're walking, you're not wobbling side to side. And really keeping that muscle intact is really key to the quicker recovery for most hip replacement patients. So if you were to say, regular surgery versus minimally invasive, would you say that overall the incisions tend to be smaller? The soft tissue dissection tends to be much more favorable and softer on the soft tissues,
mm-hmm,
whereas what we do with the bone is essentially the same,
mm-hmm,
in the end.
Yeah, I mean, I'd say that from the location of your incision, from how you expose the hip joint and how you are careful with your exposure is something that's essential to having probably fast recovery. Less muscle damage that's caused by an inadvertent retractor that we use to expose the hip joint. I think it's important to be very conscientious about where you put these various retractors. I think that having a meticulous soft tissue repair, so piece of anatomy that may have been separated on the way in is replaced on the way out. with the goal of what we do being to restore anatomy back to its original estate in the best way possible. And there's a number of surgical techniques that we employ in order to achieve that.
And you know, the surgical techniques, a lot of people are hearing about the various approaches to the hip: anterior, which is from the front; posterior, which is from the rear. There's lateral, there's anterolateral. There's also a two-incision. We use a little bit of each one to do the surgery. So all of these have their advantages and disadvantages, and you can do an MIS, minimally invasive type surgery, to any of those approaches and still get good results. I think a lot of what has driven this forward are patients who want to get back to work faster, get back to home faster. And we'll talk about ambulatory total hip, I think, towards the end of the discussion, and really get people back to a normal life as quickly as possible.
Yeah.
And whatever that takes to get them there and still give them that 20-plus year hip if we can do it, then I think we're all for doing that. And even though as surgeons it probably makes the job a little tougher for us, in the end it's better for the patient, and really it's really a patient-oriented, patient-centric type of procedure that we really want to do and really personalize it for that individual.
Yeah.
And talking about retractors, I think that's been a big change over the last 20 years. We've moved from the standard big retractors to ones that are more soft tissue friendly so that they don't damage the soft tissue when you do retract, and also instruments that curve in different ways that allow you to get in there through these little incisions so that you're not pressing on the soft tissue and muscle as much, but still getting the job done that you need to get done.
Yeah, definitely. All great points. I think, you know, once we've done the soft tissue exposure, we use these special retractors, we've done meticulous exposure, I do think that one of the things we should emphasize is that with all the techniques that we have today, whether it be excellent radiographic imaging, navigation, intraoperative x-ray, we're much more accurate at hitting our goals. And our goals meaning putting the implants in a position which leads to them being stable, which allows our patients to have the confidence to do more activity in terms of range of motion. And also, like I said, restoring the soft tissue tension so the patient feels that their normal anatomy is restored. And I think that comes down to being accurate. And I think we'll talk a little bit about how we achieve our goals in the operating room to lead to a fast recovery.
Okay. So, Peter, why don't you show them what the hip joint actually looks like? This is a model that we have.
So, to show you, this is a model. So, actually, here we're looking at, this is the front. Here you'll get the front of the body is here. So, you see, this is the front of the body. This is the back, okay? This is an image just focusing on what's called the acetabulum, or we call this the cup, pretty much because it looks like a cup or shell. This is just demonstrating an example of what arthritis is, which is a wearing out of cartilage, causing it to be quote-unquote bone-on-bone, which is a term that many people are familiar with. This is corresponding with the femur, which has the femoral head, which is shaped like a ball here.
Also known as the thigh bone, for those who don't know what femur is.
Yes, the thigh bone. And these two, when you're wearing out of cartilage on both sides, you have that bone-on-bone arthritis, which causes inflammation, stiffness, pain, and really a lot of the things that cause patients to present for hip replacement surgery.
And basically, the hip is a ball and socket joint. So the ball should be perfectly spherical. The socket or cup should be perfectly hemispherical, and they should match up completely. If they don't, that's what leads to early arthritis in patients. Now, in the replacement, the bone work is the same whether, again, we're doing it from the front, back, side, minimally invasive, maximally invasive, but basically shelling out the worn-out cartilage and bone on the socket, removing the ball, and then putting in the implant. So, Peter, why don't you show them what the cup looks like?
So, you see here, most of our modern-day implants are made with titanium, and the titanium shell has a what's called porous surface where the bone will grow into that, and we really moved in that direction for both the shell as well as the part that goes into the thigh bone because that gives us biologic fixation, so that means that's going to last for a lifetime. The way we prepare it then is we prepare the shell or the acetabulum to whatever size that's best fit for that patient, and then we insert that titanium component without cement, and basically it's called press fit into the bone, where it has intrinsic stability inside the patient's pelvis. Then over time, bone will then grow into that component. And you can see here, so I'll just point one thing, this white additional piece is actually a very special, called highly cross-linked polyethylene, a very special plastic, which at 15 years, it shows amazing wear properties. Where 20 years ago, we said, oh, hip would wear out. And since 2001, there's been no revisions for wearing out of the current plastic that we use. So it's incredibly durable.
And on the stem side, which is the thigh bone is actually hollow in that it has a what we call spongy bone in the center. So we machine that out and then literally drop in an implant that has the same porous type coating at the top, usually made out of titanium, squeezed into the bone, and then we have different size and length heads that we can put on here to match up the socket and recreate the normal mechanics of the joint as closely as possible. So we can make the leg longer, we can make it shorter, we can bring the hip out, we can bring it in to try to get it as close to what the original hip looked like so the muscles do work at their best.
Exactly.
And whether we do that through that small incision or a big one depends on a number of factors. You know, obviously patients who are very overweight, i.e. morbidly obese, if you want to call them that, the incisions are not going to be 2-3 inch incisions. You know, the minimal size incision has, you have to be able to get a cup like this in there. So you're already looking at a minimum of about 2 to 3 inches for most hip replacements to be able to get the implants in there. But obviously a bigger patient, you're going to need to make a bigger skin incision. Still, when you get deep down to the muscle, you try to preserve the muscle so that they still get the benefit of the faster recovery.
And I'll just say one more thing about, you know, the material properties that we have today. Like I said, I think that these implants could potentially last a lifetime. You know, they don't have an expiration date as some patients think. One other thing I'll say is that we have lots of options in terms of the sizing, like you mentioned, in terms of the length of this ball that we use. So we can really customize the hip replacement to match the patient's anatomy, to restore leg lengths, with millimeters of accuracy, and I think that's why we see the results that we see today.
Yeah. And how many cases would you say you do here at HSS?
At HSS, total hips probably around 6,000 total hips a year. I think that's probably around the number. The number keeps going up each year. So we really have a lot of surgeons who specialize in hip surgery, who do hundreds of these surgeries a year. So we have very established protocols that we follow that I think yield the excellent results that we see.
And I would say the overwhelming majority of are done with these minimally invasive techniques.
Yeah,
whether they're done from the front or the back.
Yeah.
They're done with.
I think, you know, a lot of the minimally invasive techniques were popularized at this hospital. The retractors that we use, a lot of them were designed here. So we're really, I think, at the leading, you know, forefront of having this philosophy of rapid recovery. And that's been the case here for over a decade, at least. Yeah. So, we have a question now from the audience, so thank you.
Yes. So, Kathleen Baumiller wants to know, she's had a hip replacement posterior 25 years ago, and now has had a dislocation about 4 times in the past year. Mm-hmm. She's been told that the liner could need to be replaced.
Yeah.
She wants to know, is that something that can be done minimally invasive?
The answer is yes. If it's strictly liner wear, and for a lot of late dislocators many years out, what happens is the plastic does wear out, so then the ball starts to sort of rock around the inside of the plastic and eventually allows it to pop out more easily. As long as there's no bone loss around the implant and the implant's not loosening, you can go in, change out the plastic if it's a modular type like this. Now, some of the older implants back in the 80s in particular were monoblocks, they were one piece, and to change that, very often you have to change the whole cup. You can still do it through probably a much smaller incision than what you had done initially, but that's always a possibility.
Yeah. So just to clarify, that's a good question. As was mentioned, that surgery was done 25 years ago. So in 2001, that's when we changed the material properties of this piece of plastic, which wore out. So we no longer see that failure mode. That's the benefit of technology, of our evolving understanding about materials. So for patients who did have the surgery done 20, 30 years ago, that can still happen. We can wear out the plastic. I would say, as Dr. Alexiadis said, if it's just the plastic that's the problem, it's a fairly straightforward procedure, because basically the parts that are growing to the bone or cemented, we leave them, we take the plastic piece out, and it's literally as easy as snapping out one piece of plastic and putting in a new piece of plastic. The incision for that only has to allow for the exposure to just visualize that anatomy to put in the new shell. You can be full weight bearing after that surgery, oftentimes. So the recovery is actually fairly fast, and some patients go home after one night in the hospital.
And most patients, the new plastic that goes in is the new type of plastic that we've been using for the last 15 years. So we're hopefully resetting the clock for your hip, so it'll hopefully last you another 20 plus years or longer.
Right.
Longer. Mm-hmm. So a very good question. And we have another one coming.
Question?
Yeah. So Jeanette Fagnoli, she'd like to know, she needs her left hip replaced. She's had her right one done in 2013, but she was out of work for 3 months, and she's a physical therapist. She's interested in minimally invasive and wants to know, how do you select a candidate? Is it age? Is it activity? What role does that play in deciding?
Sure. I'll start. I'd say that I think that, with our current techniques here, usually we can get patients back to work prior to 3 months. I mean, every situation is obviously unique. I think return to work, we like to see is somewhere between, depending on obviously the occupation that you do, that's one of the things that's a question. But usually within 6 weeks, we can see most patients back to their occupation, I would say. In terms of, we talked before, the candidates for minimally invasive, I mean, the same perioperative protocols are applied to all patients. That means, spinal anesthesia for us, okay? That means having an injection of numbing medication in the hip joint. That means meticulous surgical technique, and that means putting the implants in a perfect fashion, right? Those things will basically usually generate a recovery that is fast and predictable. So the length of the incision, as Dr. Lexiadis has mentioned, is based oftentimes on the soft tissue, on the size of the patient. To specify, I do posterior approach total hip replacement, and my patients go through the same perioperative protocols and I think recovery as Dr. Alexiadis do for the anterior hip replacement. And everyone, in my eyes, is a candidate for that, if that makes sense. Yeah.
And the post-op PT also very important, basically to get the patient mobilized. What we do here for many patients is we do a prehab visit. When they come for their pre-op test, they also see a physical therapist and basically learn what they have to do post-op before they're in the hospital, before they're given medications for post-op pain, and they're going to be somewhat woozy. Hard to teach someone all that stuff so that it's retained. Mm-hmm. So by doing it before, patients are getting out of the hospital faster. We've been doing ambulatory total hip replacements here for quite a while, and we're working on making it a more standard option for patients who want to go home the same day. And as long as they've got good pain control and it's safe for them to go home, we want them to go home. Because frankly, I'd rather sleep in my own bed rather than sleeping, even though our beds are very hot, very comfortable here, I'd rather sleep in my own bed.
Yeah. Now, say, one other thing I mentioned is that in terms of the speed of the recovery now, I think we've learned with our understanding about how the pelvis moves in space, so we've optimized our positioning of our components. I think with using larger femoral heads, which is this piece here, because we have such good materials, we have more intrinsic stability in our hip replacements, that we've removed some of the precautions that are required after surgery. I think that some of the limitations in those first 6 weeks that prevented people from being able to drive, being able to sit in a normal seat, sleeping on their side, were precautions that were employed 20 years ago when we had a very different way of doing hip surgery. I think we did research here looking at hundreds of patients, minimizing basically the precautions after surgery, found no difference in the rate of dislocation and really acceleration in their recovery. So I'm hoping that, with the prehab, with teaching those two positions that we like patients to avoid, with good perioperative care and limiting the precautions, that patients can get back to work much faster.
Yeah. And I think also what we do in terms of implant selection is going to be important for patients. For instance, an older patient who's a bit osteoporotic, rather than using a non-cemented implant, which we just press fit, that puts a lot of stress on the bone and we may need to protect their weight bearing, we may cement or glue the implant in, which provides instant fixation. It lasts just as long as the non-cemented and allows them to put full weight on it. So depending on the patient's bone structure, we're going to do what will give them the best recovery in terms of both pain relief, being able to bear weight, and get back to their normal activities as quickly as possible. So it's really trying to personalize it for each individual patient. And another question.
Yes. So this one is from Jacqueline Vecchio. She had her right hip replaced last year, and she wants to know, is it normal for the scar to still hurt for such a long period of time?
The answer is yes. It can be sore for quite some time. I tell patients to, take a look at the scar, and it's kind of your thermometer of how active healing is going on inside the joint. So if the scar is still very red, very raised, very hot, that means there's still a lot of, we call it metabolic stuff going on deep inside. The scarring is maturing, the bone is maturing, etc. But as that scar starts to calm down, it starts to turn normal skin color, gets less raised, less tender. It means that the deep tissues are also starting to heal at the same rate. So I tell patients, use the scar as your thermometer. If it's still tender a year out, you're probably on the longer end of that soreness scale. Most patients, typically by about 9 months, it starts to subside. But some can take a year and a half for that to happen.
Yeah. I think so, early on, we try to minimize the amount of sutures that we put right below the skin, because sometimes when they dissolve, that can cause an irritation. Obviously, this patient is farther out, those sutures have dissolved, but we try to be mindful of how much material we have in that superficial skin layer. I'd say some patients can have maybe some hypersensitivity, and we recommend actually something touching massage to try to desensitize the scar, which can sometimes be helpful. Sometimes like we have a patch that can kind of provide some numbing medication that can make the scar feel better. We don't, it can happen, but over time, it should resolve.
Okay. We also have another question from Maureen. What is the incidence of nerve damage with an anterior approach? And if it's a quick return to work, is that a concern? That's her question.
Okay, being the anterior approach guy, I have the most experience with this. And if you look at the literature, the percentages range anywhere from about 2% to about 10-15% of patients getting what's called a nerve palsy of a sensory nerve, which is a branch of a nerve that comes right across the front of the hip and goes to the outer thigh skin. We typically avoid hitting it or moving it, but nerves really don't like being retracted very much, and so sometimes that nerve will stop working and you end up with a numb patch on the outer part of the thigh. The overwhelming majority of patients who get that, doesn't bother them. In other words, it's not painful. When they touch it, they don't feel uncomfortable or dysesthesias. And because it's a sensory nerve, it does not affect muscle function. So you can return to sports and still do everything. But the percentages of seeing that have dropped over the years as we've gotten better with doing the anterior approach, in terms of less soft tissue dissection, etc. It can happen on a rare occasion where you get a painful type of neuritis involving that, but in my experience of over 3,000, I've only had one or two patients who had that, and we treated it with pain management and it got better, but ultimately did not affect the person's function at all.
I have another question. This is from Cheryl Markham. She wants to know, what is the average length of time before full weight can be put on a non-cemented anterior approach implant? And should one avoid lifting heavy objects such as a wheelbarrow for any other recommendations that you may have?
I think it's question for anterior. Mm-hmm. For posterior, you put weight bearing right away. We have great visualization, so the parts go in very solid, so pretty confident with our current methods, you can put full weight bearing. And patients wean off of their assisted devices over the first 2 weeks. So, you're on a cane for maybe, 2 weeks after surgery, and then you're walking on your own. But obviously, you know, if you're concerned about bone quality, you know, you're not going to put in an uncemented implant. You'd be more inclined to maybe use cement. And then in those patients, you can also put full weight bearing. So in my practice, I've never protected the weight bearing of a hip replacement patient.
And in my practice, which is again the anteriors, same thing. I usually let them weight bear right away, and a lot of them are off their cane usually within days to a week or two after the surgery. One of the problems, however, with, I'll call it, these minimally invasive techniques where things hurt a lot less than they used to, is patients tend to do too much, which then causes too much stress through the implant transmitted to the bone, and can result in things like thigh pain or groin pain, which can persist sometimes for weeks or months. So I actually try to slow my patients down because they want to do too much. And so the incidence of things like stress fractures or stress reactions around the implant are much more infrequent. But we have surgeons here who protect weight bear patients for 2 to 3 weeks minimum because they worry about these stress reactions. But if you look at the literature in general, you can weight bear pretty much immediately if you get good fixation. And as Peter and I have said, if we're not sure that the fixation's great or the bone's not going to be able to take the stress well, I'm going to go right to a cemented stem, which takes care of all those problems, allows the patient to bear weight right away.
There were a few people who joined us kind of late and missed your explanation between anterior and posterior. Mm-hmm. Could you run through that again and give an explanation?
Sure. So on the posterior approach, sir, so basically a posterior approach, you are splitting the gluteus maximus muscle. You're not cutting any muscle, you're basically separating it to gain access into the hip joint. It preserves the abductor muscle, as the anterior approach does, which is the most important muscle for walking, and we don't really touch that muscle or the gluteus. It's called gluteus medius and gluteus minimus. Parts go in very specifically based on good templating. We have excellent exposure, so we put our parts in and we visualize the anatomy very, very well, and that leads us to very accurate, I think, reproducible results. And then you perform a meticulous anatomic closure on the way out. I'd say in terms of recovery, patients leave usually after one night in the hospital, they're on their cane for an average, some patients are off the cane in a few days, 2 weeks, depends on the patient. They're back to full activity, walking without a limp, happy in, you know, weeks, I'd say, in a couple weeks. It's a very fast, predictable recovery, and it's a very satisfying occupation, being a posterior approach total hip surgeon.
And as an anterior approach surgeon, I'll echo what he says in that we try to minimize any of the soft tissue injury. But unlike the posterior approach, we're not going to split a muscle. We're going to go in between two muscles to do the surgery. At least in my hands, I find that the patients have less pain, up and around faster, usually getting them out the day after surgery, but many are going home the same day. But that is not just approach related. I know excellent hip surgeons who do posterior approach that send most of their patients home the same day. So it's not the approach necessarily, but the surgeon and the techniques used at surgery and post-op in terms of pain management to allow this quick, rapid recovery. Yeah.
I think one thing I'd mention, because we're running out of time, is that the discussion today in the media and the news is really focusing on approaches, anterior, having more enthusiasm about being minimally invasive. You know, as a posterior hip surgeon, I think if you go to a high volume surgeon, Dr. Alexiadis does hundreds of hip surgeries a year, you're going to have an excellent outcome and a fast recovery. I like to say that I do hundreds of hip surgeries a year, I have excellent results, my patients have a fast recovery. A lot of it comes down to, as we mentioned, good pain, you know, good anesthesia, meticulous surgical technique, meticulous implant placement, the modifications that we've made over the last 15 years in our retractors and our implant design, and that leads us to have fast recovery and happy patients. Whether it's anterior or posterior, I think it's dealer's choice as to what you choose. Going to a high volume surgeon who's a specialty in this field is probably most important in my opinion. I'll let Dr. Alexiadis maybe say what he thinks about that.
But, yeah, we've done a number of studies comparing our anteriors to posteriors. You know, if there is a difference, it's very early on, but if you look at things that like the real important things, which is how long the implant is going to last by putting it in the right position, no matter which approach you use, it ends up being the same. And frankly, in this institution, where we do so many anteriors and posteriors, both with and without navigation and robotics, we find that even the navigation robotics doesn't change where, how we're putting the implants in. Because we do a lot of them, we're really good at doing them, and our patients are really, really happy. And whatever we can do to make them happier without compromising the results, we're going to do that. All right, so I want to thank you all for joining us. I hope that's answered a few questions, and have a good evening.
Thank you very much.